Many people in modern societies agree that the well-being of animals is morally important. This is why the discipline of animal welfare science was created a few decades ago. It was not merely the result of academic interest. The development of this field was possible because it received the public funding it needed. This was motivated by the pressure of public opinion in favor of taking the well-being of animals seriously. In the decades that have passed since then, public interest has only increased. Why then hasn't there been research about the well-being of animals in the wild? An answer to this may be that there are several common misconceptions and confusions about the lives of animals in the wild that have led many people to believe that there's no reason to worry about what happens to them. Most people don't know about the harms these animals suffer and are not aware that the majority of animals in the wild die prematurely, in many cases due to painful causes. As people are not always aware of the many ways there are of helping them. So public concern for the well-being of animals could be an important force towards establishing welfare biology as a field. The example of animal welfare science shows that supportive public attitudes could lead to the creation of welfare biology as well. Just as with domesticated animals, public support could potentially lead to funding for such research. This would give an opportunity for scientists concerned about wild animals to focus on advancing this field. In fact, given the public concern about domesticated animals, and now that we've seen what the lives of animals in the wild are actually like, there is good reason for the public to support a field that aims to understand and reduce wild animal suffering. Scientists working in the science of ecology and related fields are much more familiar than the general public with the situation of animals in the wild. These scientists could be another driving force in promoting research on this topic. There's an explanation for why this has not yet happened. Scientists work within certain paradigms that dictate what lines of inquiry are appropriate for science. These paradigms concern, among other things, the key assumptions, methods, and questions that are asked in each field. They are partly theoretical and conceptual, but they also have another component, one that concerns the final aims of research. Humans are not interested in just any knowledge. While knowing the total number of stars in the universe can be interesting, counting the total number of grains of sand on a beach may not be. While most societies are interested in some questions out of pure intellectual curiosity, in many other cases, research is undertaken to help achieve certain goals. This is the ethical component of the scientific paradigm, because ethics has to do with the ultimate goals we try to achieve with our actions. According to the paradigm that prevailed in ecology for most of the 20th century, and that is still strongly influential, the primary goal of research was the promotion of human interests. For the past few decades, conservation has been another important aim of the science of ecology. This might explain, at least in part, why non-human animals are not usually treated as individuals with interests. In fact, they are typically seen as important only as functional parts of ecosystems or as representatives of abstract entities such as species or populations. Within this framework, ecologists in particular and biologists more generally might see little practical interest in research into the well-being of individual animals. They could have trouble thinking of them as individuals with interests, so these questions might not occur to them. Due to this, we might think that such questions would not be interesting in biology. But there is nothing about this subject that would make it an inappropriate area of study in biology. The fact that animals have lives that can go better or worse for them from the point of view of their own well-being is one of the things that happens in the natural world and part of a proper description of it. Life scientists, like other scientists, seek to improve our understanding of the world. If we ignore something significant happening within it, such as the fact that animals have well-being, we are missing a part of what would constitute such an understanding. There are good reasons for scientists to be interested in studying factors related to the well-being of animals living in the wild. This would advance our knowledge, and researchers with no interest in promoting the well-being of animals could find this knowledge useful for other purposes. This could happen in animal ecology, and in particular the study of animal behavior, because animals' well-being affects how animals behave. It is also relevant for the design of field studies, because the studies can affect the animals' well-being. For example, when animals are made to carry relatively large GPS tracking devices, this would cause animals to behave differently. So the results of such studies could be compromised. Having said this, there is no reason why scientists couldn't also share the values that many people in contemporary society have towards non-human animals. Given that in our society, many people do care about animals as sentient beings, and given that some of these people are scientists, There is no reason why this cannot also be something that motivates research in biology to improve the situation of animals. Independent people and organizations like Animal Ethics can do important work by spreading the idea that wild animal suffering is a serious issue and that it would be good to gain more knowledge about it and how to undertake it. This can be done among academics and students, but also among the general public. Independent researchers can also play a part in the development of welfare biology by doing research that complements what is done by academics. This research could be just as useful and as rigorous as the one academics can carry out. In addition, organizations can do some research that scholars are not carrying out yet, especially when it involves expressing explicitly ethical concerns. Scholars often try to avoid this and to focus only on the facts of the matter, even though their research ultimately always has some purpose entailing an ethical choice. For example, the search for what is good for human health or the development of human knowledge, which is chosen over any other alternative goals. Independent organizations, on the other hand, are more likely to present the ethical implications of the research they carry out. This could be useful for exploring further questions beyond what scholars might be ready to research at a given time. A way that people and groups concerned about wild animal suffering can have a huge impact today is by focusing on promoting the establishment of welfare biology as a new field of research in academia. In fact, there are several reasons why doing this might be necessary in order to be able to meaningfully help wild animals. These reasons include 1, the quantity and quality of the research required, 2, how that research is applied in practice and policy making, and 3, the potential to fundamentally change how people think about the issue. Regarding the quality and quantity of the research, academics have access to a variety of resources that can help them with their research in welfare biology. Academics are also typically highly specialized and can spend long periods of time working on specific problems. In addition, they can influence other academics to do similar work. As for how that research can be applied in practice and in policymaking, we must bear in mind that academics and academic work are taken seriously in our society, more than people interested in the protection of animals are, especially by policy and lawmakers. When policymakers need to know about the feasibility and implications of a certain policy, they typically ask scientists and academics rather than society in general. This means that it will be very difficult for actual policies aiding wild animals to be implemented if they aren't backed by scientists. For this to happen, it won't be sufficient for only a few isolated scholars to work in the field. Rather, we need a recognized field of research involving scholars from different institutions around the world. Finally, the role of academics is especially important when it comes to changing how people think about issues. This is not only due to their general influence in society, but also because scientific paradigms are taught at universities to new generations of people. If the biology of animals' well-being is established within academia, it will eventually be taught to new generations of scientists. This will contribute to people's perception of what the lives of animals living in the wild are actually like. It is also likely to increase their moral consideration of these animals. This doesn't mean that the only work we need to do to establish welfare biology is to promote academic research in this field. As we have seen before, there are many things that independent organizations working on the subject can do, such as raising awareness or doing their own research about the situation of animals in the wild. Independent researchers can also play a role by doing work on this topic and by helping organizations with their work. But what we have seen so far indicates that while these actions are vital, spreading research about welfare biology in academia seems to be crucial.